behind me is Victorio Peak, a mountain that's surrounded with legend, mystery. They say there's a lot of gold under there, and the people have certainly shown up to see if it's there. Norman Scott, the leader of Expeditions Unlimited, has come with advanced electronic equipment to look inside the mountain. With him have come droves of other claimants who say it's their gold. And following all them has been scores of reporters. At the end of 10 days, we're going to see if there's gold in them hills.
Legends of millions of dollars of gold abound in the Southwest. There's the Lost Dutchman Mine in Arizona's Superstition Mountains. There are stories of Coronado's gold and Maximilian's gold and hundreds of others. One of the most interesting stories is about a man called Doc Noss. His real name was Milton E. Noss. He's a foot doctor from Hot Springs, New Mexico. He and his wife, Ova, went deer hunting in 1937, about 25 miles east of Hatch, New Mexico. Doc climbed a rugged little mountain to see if there were any deer below. It was called Victorio Peak, named after Mescalero Apache chief Victorio. He kicked a loose rock and felt a blast of air come from within the mountain. Closer inspection revealed a large, deep, square shaft straight down in the chimney of Victorio Peak. Doc saw an old rope ladder that was hanging into the darkness below. Later, he came back to explore the shaft and discovered a large network of interconnecting caverns. After a lot of searching, Doc found some artifacts, including Spanish armor and enough gold coins to load 60 to 80 pack mules. At the very deepest part of the cavern, about 2,700 feet from the entrance, he found gold bars that were stacked like cordwood in three piles. There were 16,000 bars, each weighing 60 to 80 pounds. Doc also found a grisly sight, 27 human skeletons bound in chains. For the next 2 years, Doc moved some 200 bars to the surface, one at a time. In 1939, he hired an engineer to dynamite a restricted opening to provide him with easier access to the treasure. That was a mistake. The charge was too powerful, and the subsequent cave-in sealed the entrance to the treasure. Doc was shot in the back of the head and killed in 1949 after an argument with Charlie Ryan, a man who told Doc he would buy some of the gold bars which Doc had already brought to the surface. Ova Noss continued to work at the site, attempting to gain access to the treasure room using information that Doc had left her. In 1955, the U.S. Army forced Mrs. Noss off of the site, claiming it was part of the White Sands missile test range. In 1961, H.L. Moreland and R.B. Gray discovered the U.S. Army digging with heavy equipment, shoring timbers, and mining equipment at the Noss site. In 1963, the Army allowed the Gaddis Mining Company 60 days to explore the site using heavy equipment. At the conclusion of the search, nothing was found. The story surfaced 10 years later, during the Watergate hearings, when John Dean testified that noted attorney F. Lee Bailey had talked with Attorney General John Mitchell seeking access to White Sands Missile Range. Bailey said he represented anonymous claimants who knew where millions of dollars of treasure was buried. F. Lee Bailey contacted Norman Scott, the head of Expeditions Unlimited of Pompano Beach, Florida, to head up a search for the gold. After several delays, the Secretary of the Army granted Scott a 10-day search permit to enter White Sands Missile Range in March 1977 to confirm or disprove the legend of Victorio Peak.
We hope this will put the legends to rest once and for all. The Army has maintained from the beginning that there is no lost treasure in White Sands Missile Range. The two previous attempts to locate treasure further substantiated our position. The legend lives on, however. In the event Mr. Scott does locate any treasure, I assure you we will be as surprised as anyone. If he doesn't, perhaps we will not be constantly bombarded by queries and questions on this topic, and we can concentrate on our effort, which is our primary mission of testing missiles. Is that?
First of all, I think it's important to note that the Secretary of the Army is the one who approved this venture, approved it in concept, not White Sands Missile Range. The Army does not recognize any individual rights to anything which may be found in Victoria Peak or any other place on the range, insofar as it's an item of substantial value. We don't recognize anybody's rights. We don't say that one person has it, another person doesn't. We're just not commenting on it.
That the role of Expeditions Unlimited here is simply to validate or not validate the alleged gold stories. We do not believe, nor do we disbelieve, this particular story. I can tell you publicly that 70 to 80, maybe even 90% of this particular rumors and legends are not based on fact. I can factually document that at the appropriate time. However, there still remains the point of 10, 20%, or whatever small percentage you wish to use that is and in a position of it cannot be refuted, and there seems to be a preponderance of circumstantial evidence that it may be factual. What we really have to do is to prove conclusively one little piece of gold out of this little area. Then, at that point, if that comes about, and that can come about, in my opinion, in 11 days, then perhaps the Army would graciously consider further discussions on a lengthy operation.
Mr. Scott in no way represents Ove Noss or the Ove Noss group. Mrs. Noss, as early as 1937, with her husband, found this treasure. There really is no disputing that. The entry, however, on March 19, tomorrow, is too limited. It's just a quick look around, and that is not enough. We have given consent to this entry upon specific assurances from the General Counsel's staff of the Department of Defense that the success or the failure of the Scott survey during this short entry will not be used by the Army to prevent future entry to the site in the manner that Mrs. Noss insists is really required to accomplish anything and obtain the reopening of the original treasure caverns.
The next morning at sunrise, the lines were drawn and everyone's position was clear. The Army didn't believe there was treasure on White Sands Missile Range. They only wanted to end the rumors. Norman Scott didn't know whether or not there was gold there, but he hoped there would be. As for the Nosses, they wanted it made clear that Expeditions Unlimited was not searching for Doc's find with their cooperation. The other groups were more mysterious. All that was clear was a lot of people were represented by F. Lee Bailey, and they too believed they could find their supposed entrances. The search was on. We arrived at Upham Exit from Interstate 25 for the beginning of Operation Gold Finder, a 30-mile trek through the desert to the entrance of White Sands Missile Range, a place where, from that first morning on, we would be stopped and asked whether or not we were carrying weapons and then sent on our way.
Morning, Major Abel. How are you doing?
Good morning. How are you all this morning?
Oh, we're doing just fine. How about yourself?
I'm going to put you over here so you use your own vehicle.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
Make a lot easier for you. Four-wheel drive, you won't have any sweat.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
From there, we went on to Hellsite, USA, an Army outpost in the middle of nowhere, the location where the Army had been guarding Victorio Peak since 1971, although it was at least 3 miles from the mountain itself. Each morning, all the claimants and the workers would be checked in and have their vehicles thoroughly searched. From this point, the Army provided transportation to those who didn't have suitable vehicles. And every morning, along with all the other hardy souls, we'd see Ove Noss, an 81-year-old grandmother, waiting in line to show identification and be allowed entrance to the land that she claims a 99-year lease with the state.
Are they going to let you in?
I don't know. That remains to be seen. Going to my own execution, don't have my IDs with me.
What are you going to do if they don't let you in today?
Well, I'll stand there and watch you fellas.
The tentative schedule of what we're going to do right now. We've all been cleared. Appreciate your patience. It takes a little while to clear this many people initially. The plan is as follows. We will proceed down to the base of the canyon. We will park our vehicles. The F. Lee Bailey and Patterson group claimants will ascend the hill, and we will designate and mark off an area that we wish to excavate. Shortly, we will be talking to the Ove Noss group and David Darr. They are here. Hopefully that they will cooperate with us on giving any further information that they might have to add on this. This is a matter that is up in the air at this particular moment. Following the marking off on areas, perhaps two areas, A and B, on Victoria Peak, we will then proceed down on an easterly direction to an aurora, where we will find the Bloody Hands. This specific area is an entrance to a shaft or tunnel, which the further group of Mr. Hull and Mr. Tipton of the Effley Bailey Patterson group will designate an area. We will mark these areas off today. It will go rather slowly. The bulldozer, the front end loader, will not be arriving on base till tomorrow. We do not anticipate any actual excavation, perhaps until Monday. The scientific activity will take place tomorrow, verifying the verbal representations by the claimants to us today.
Mrs. Noss was permitted entrance, and we were off again. Destination, Victorio Peak. The first view of the embryo basin is astounding. It's a panoramic view of the huge valley where so much history has taken place and where, according to some, there may be enough gold to stagger the imagination. Victoria Peak sits in the center of the basin, where it's easily spotted, not because of its size, because as mountains go, it's pretty small, only about 400 feet high at most. But what does stand out are the tremendous scars that have been inflicted by men and women in quest of a legend. The ride into the basin is rough, with sharp declines and hairpin curves. We all made it safely, though, and we finally were in a position to look up at what was to become our home away from home for days to come. Once we parked and gathered the necessary gear, there was no hesitating. People from all groups and the press began scurrying up the side of the peak, making sure not to fall behind, lest someone find the treasure without them. There wasn't a treasure to be found that first day, though. The main activity was claimants, who quickly spread out to stake their claim to the hidden entrances. They would be checked later and charted.
First assault on Victoria Peak is complete. The claimants are here. They're staking out a place where they believe is a likely place where the gold may be stored. We'll know more later. They say they won't do any actual digging until Sunday or Monday at the earliest. The heavy equipment isn't here. As for now, all we can do is wait.
Well, I think we should have a talk and see if there can't be some meeting of the minds, because I think the hour is now. And I don't disagree with the fact that if something is found, that, you know, you're going to need a lengthy excavation. But unless you establish something at this 11 days, it's just axiomatic to me that you're right back where you were in 1955. None of us are getting any older or younger.
Yeah, I found that out coming to you.
So would you see if you could get David and I and perhaps over to talk when we get down around lunchtime?
The first site to be considered was one called Snake Hole or Soldier's Hole. The Nosses originally named it Snake Hole for what they refer to as obvious reasons. When they first entered it, it was full of rattlers. Norman Scott called it Soldier's Hole because of evidence that an Army officer had entered into the cave in prior years. As a preliminary step to assaulting the cave, Lambert Dolphin, the chief physicist at Stanford Research Institute, looked inside the mountain with ground radar to determine whether or not there were caverns below.
Of the ground radar and the verbiage of three now collaborating witnesses over almost a decade and a half, if you can establish the credibility of the existence of these rooms, you have gone a long way to proving the fact that Doc Noss was giving factual information.
Right, sure. Okay, I want to see your diagram so that I had some idea of the geometry.
I hereby give it to you.
What's mine to keep?
Be careful, it's a treasure map.
Three men entered Soldier's Hole the first time. They were Jerry Lee, as a representative of Expeditions Unlimited, Jack Hall, an oil man from Oklahoma who had visited the mountain, unknown to the Army, several times in recent years, and retired Captain Leonard Feige, who claims to have found the treasure in 1959 while serving at White Sands Missile Range.
Are you excited? Well, I'm not necessarily excited. I'm pleased. My schedule was to make the first excavation on Monday. This is still Sunday, so we're perhaps in this field a little bit ahead of schedule. I don't expect too much from this particular hole, but this is one of the entrances that have been repeatedly brought forth in our research, and we must check it out. You may come back and say it's nothing but a hole.
After a little over an hour inside the mountain, the men emerged, confirming that there was a large room called the Dome Room about 200 feet in, and that another room, the Ring Room, which Figi had talked about, was caved in and inaccessible.
Goes back a good distance. I don't know how long the rope was stretched out, but I went back probably 100 feet further than the rope was stretched out. I did reach a point that was a dead end. There has been a lot of work done in there by somebody.
Now, that is the hole that Captain Figi says that he went through in 1958-59 and saw the substantial catch of gold. Now, that is the hole that Jack Hull went in 1970 and saw a active mining operation there. That is the hole that other members of the Joe Newman Group have been in and explored.
Remember that Captain Figi was not the first person to go down into that hole. When you talk to the Noss family, to Ova, and if I recall correctly, to Letha, now they've been down the Snake Hole and explored it back in the old days. So the issue is, what did they find then? Now, I don't know how deep they were specifically, and I'm not so sure that they measured it accurately, but they make no claim that the Snake Hole contained the entry into the vault that had the gold in it.
The next day again started with a dusty journey in convoy and the prospect of exploring a new area, a day that helped to shape events for the remainder of the expedition. Today, we would visit Bloody Hands.
This area is known as Bloody Hands. The reason? A group of Indian paintings that stretch along the entire ledge here, several hundred feet. Among them, a group of red hands, so it's been named Bloody Hands. The reason they're digging here today, first by hand, later by bulldozer, if it arrives, it's had some trouble at the port of entry, is because of a map that Benny Samaniego had back when he worked for Doc many years ago. It indicated that there may be treasure, according to some of the paintings on the wall, a small treasure buried somewhere under here. This is not a Noss group, Noss claim. This is a Patterson-Bailey claim, and the Nosses have never said there is any gold in this position.
There was a feeling of coming success at the Bloody Hand site. There was visible evidence that Indians had lived there, and rumor that writings on the wall told of treasure. But there was bad news, too. Norman Scott had fallen while exploring a cave and had torn the ligaments in his right arm. He was medevaced by Army helicopter to a hospital in Las Cruces, where a doctor there told him he must have surgery within a week or risk losing the use of his arm. He then returned to the peak, losing only 3 hours at most. When he returned, there was more bad news. A state archaeologist had found evidence of early man and shut down the Bloody Hand site as a state historical location.
Not really. Mm-hmm. So gold digging in the Bloody Hands.
Yeah. I consider cultural remains, uh-huh. Which are definitely cultural remains,
right.
And what constitute an archaeological site.
Mm-hmm.
At that point, I just determined that it was important enough to stop the digging going on at there. There was.
What did you find?
We found these two flakes. Mm-hmm. Both of these came out of the hole. I found this one in the wall of their trench. I found this one in some of the dirt that was in the bottom of the trench, the hole that they're putting in there. Now, these were not the only things that led me to believe it was a site.
Soldier's Hole and Bloody Hand site were both dead ends, so the next try would be a place where the Gannis Mining Company had searched without results in 1963. Its name, Bat Cave.
This may only go 30 feet.
Uh-huh.
And if it does, again, I want it mapped. I want it measured.
Every person who entered a cave, both reporters and expedition people, were frisked, going in and coming out, to prevent both salting the mine or not reporting gold that was found on the site. Kevin Henry and Jerry Lee, both who worked for Norman Scott, were the first to enter the Bat Cave. Their job would be an easy one.
This is Bat Cave, one more hole that's been ruled out as a possible entrance to the treasure room. They came in here believing that 13 feet to that side, there'd be another entrance into the Dome Room. They dug for several hours, reaching a rock ledge, and decided to abort this hole.
It had been a long and tiring day for everyone involved, especially the folks in Expeditions Unlimited. First, we went to the Bloody Hand site and got our hopes up. Next, we rushed back to the base camp to see what had happened to Norman Scott. Then, the archaeologist closed down the Bloody Hand site, and Norman, with his arm disabled, called off all excavations at both Bloody Hands and the Bat Cave.
How y'all doing today?
How are you doing?
Just fine. Do you have any weapons in the vehicle, sir?
No, not today.
Not today? You had some earlier?
We slipped a few past you.
Oh, well, that's life.
The next morning, we heard a story that someone was trying to salt the mine with fake gold bars. If it was true, it could only serve to discredit the entire expedition and prove that the Army was right in denying that gold was buried at White Sands Missile Range.
Northern I am, it's kind of, you know.
What'd you think about somebody trying to salt the mine?
That's why I called it a liar's convention.
So it didn't surprise you then?
Not a bit in the world.
Early in the day, we asked Major Abel what he knew about the salting episode.
I have no information about anybody being arrested. You mean pertaining to this operation?
Yes, sir.
I know nothing.
Salting a mine.
I'd rather not make any comments on it.
We asked him about the salting again later in the day.
White Sands Missile Range received information that an attempt would be made to salt the search area with fake gold bars. Army officials discussed this matter with Mr. Scott of Expeditions Unlimited and a representative of the claimant group concerned. The representative of the claimant group stated he would ask the individuals concerned not to return to the installation. No Army personnel spoke to the individuals concerned at any time on this matter. That's the end of my statement. Now, fire away.
Was anybody actually did anybody come out here and then the Army turned them away?
The Army did not turn anyone away. I think it would be most inappropriate for me to discuss what group it was.
Well, Doc, this is one of the stories he used to tell, that if you gained access to this tunnel here, it would lead you to the deeper tunnels.
Is there any history, like some of the other histories, people know that the other entrances have been dynamited or otherwise closed off? How is this one closed off, do you know?
It's caved in just from decomposing of the mountain.
And right now you're just hoping that it's just the outer shell that's caved in?
That's what we hope.
Legend tells of an opening large enough to drive pack burros into the side of Victorio Peak. But excavation and survey with electronic equipment only helped to disprove one more story.
Most of the leads that we have gotten, we have now dismissed, with the exceptions of the ones that we are concentrating on in around Victoria Peak. When we are through, regardless of the outcome of the find or not find, we will have a complete geological report, and we will know and show you and give to you a picture of this mountain. But we have the ability to look inside this mountain. There are some restrictions to that. We cannot see right through the mountain. But if we put the ground radar or resistivity meters in, we are able to see as much as 100 feet in all directions accurately, depending upon the conditions of the strata at that point.
This is the chimney site, the first site that Doc Noss came upon while on a deer hunting trip in 1938. It's the first Noss site also to be checked. Two men are down there now determining how deep it is, where the blockage is, if there is any at all.
As you might imagine,
this spot has changed quite a bit since Doc originally came upon it. It was originally 8x8. It's smaller now. The Army's placed a grid over it to keep other people from going down in it and to make it just a little bit safer. Lambert Dolphin from Stanford Research Institute plans a trip down in there later, depending on what Kevin and Jerry come up with. He'll take his radar equipment in there to determine just how deep the blockage is.
On the ninth day of Operation Goldfinder, the skies turned to overcast. And with time running out and searchers' nerves starting to fray, the search narrowed to the chimney site, the site that Ove Noss contended the gold was hidden from the very beginning.
We know where the cavern is. We are approximately 30 feet above it. Whether we can break through or not is problematical. The areas of the Bloody Hands, all of the leads from the Bailey-Patterson group, all of the leads have been aborted, and there will be a final report before we leave, advising you of our conclusions on those, which are basically negative. The ground radar indicates there's only 30 feet of overburden. Coincidentally, Mrs. Norse advised before we took the measurement that it was about 34 feet, and her source was the late Doc Norse.
After a climb that normally exhausts a young man, Ova Norse has made it to the chimney, and she's conferring just one more time with Norman Scott to make sure that they have their notes to correct, to make sure that what she knows down there is fact. And at this point, it seems that it is fact, that everything she said about the hole so far is still proving true.
Time and money ran out for all, and due to some miscalculation in the digging through 30 feet of overfill, access to the lower caverns was not obtained. Does this, though, put an end to the legend that surrounds this mysterious little mountain?
The existence of the alleged Norse caverns is likely to be found in the original bottom of the Norse shaft near where it intersects bed B. Now, let me reiterate again, ladies and gentlemen, that the purpose of Expeditions Unlimited, short 12, 13, 14-day mission here, was to prove or disprove the existence of gold on precise locations furnished us by a series of claimants. Unfortunately and regrettably, the claimants or their sources were misinformed. We found no gold in the exact spots, and there is no gold in the exact spots that these claimants gave to us.
Another chapter in the long history of Victorio Peak is complete. After 11 days of gouging and probing this mysterious mountain, yet another group of treasure hunters is leaving, exhausted and disappointed. What lies beneath the floor of this embryo basin remains just a legend. There are some things that have come out of this trip, though. Facts. Fact one, there is a large network of caverns that runs beneath the base of the mountain. Fact two, there's been large-scale excavation of Victorio Peak prior to 1977. And another fact, Ova Norse, an 81-year-old grandmother from Clovis, New Mexico, knows at least part of what's down there. Along with the facts, there's some questions. Did Doc Norse actually find a legendary treasure that equaled billions of dollars? If so, who put it there and why? And again, if so, is it still there? If not, who took it out?